Welcome to the better part. Do you know what biodynamic farming is? Today we're going to learn from a certified biodynamic farmer all about biodynamic farming. Welcome to the better part, a program that encompasses a diverse spectrum of topics important to our community, which we hope will both inform and entertain you. We invite you to sit back and enjoy the program. Welcome to the better part. I'm Susan Davis, and today my guest is Cynthia Sandberg from Love Apple Farm. Welcome, Cynthia. This is just great to have you here with us today.
Thank you, Susan.
This is amazing.
I tried to bring the whole farm with me.
It's great. I just love it. We're surrounded by all of these incredible edible greens, and I'm so anxious to hear about how you raise these biodynamically.
Mm-hmm.
That's a little bit different word than we're used to.
It is.
So can you tell me, first tell me a little bit about yourself. You don't look like a farmer.
Well, I don't know if I should say thank you or harumph. I'm not sure which, if that's a compliment or not, because I'm proud to be a farmer. But I did start my professional career as an attorney. And that was a little bit of the dark side. Now I've come to the light side and am farming for a living and loving it, really enjoying farming for a living.
Well, I can see how you would, because I've actually had the wonderful experience of being at Love Apple Farm, and it is idyllic.
Thank you.
Absolutely the most wonderful place. And we all know the word organic. But biodynamic, that's a little bit different. Can you explain to us what biodynamic farming is?
Biodynamic farming is actually the granddaddy of organic farming. It was created by a gentleman by the name of Rudolf Steiner, an Austrian, back in the 1920s. He was approached by farmers in Europe looking to find out what was wrong with the crops and the fields and the yields and the increased pests and diseases that they were having in Europe. And they approached Steiner because he was a philosopher and a great thinker and a Renaissance man, very well esteemed in Europe. So they asked him if he could figure out what the problem was. And this was post-World War I, when they started to use a lot of petrochemical fertilizers on the fields. And he, after a couple of years of research, decided that there was too much of that going on, and we needed to harken back to an olden day where the farms were creating their own fertility with compost and animal manures and cover crops and treating the land and the animals in a more gentle fashion. And that was even before the term organic farming started up in the 1940s. So it's been around for about 100 years.
And what is different about it than what we think of when we think organic?
Well, there are some key differences. One, an organic farmer is not required to have animals on his farm, and a biodynamic farmer is required to have an animal component so that we take the manures from the animal, compost them, put them out on the fields. Another basic difference is that we have to save our own seed. So the idea that Steiner came up with is that a farm is supposed to be a closed-loop system. That they are supposed to create their own fertility, save their own seed, eat the animals that they grow, and in a reverential and loving fashion. They're supposed to feed the animals from the crops that they grow as well. And that closed-loop system means that the farm relies very less and less on outside inputs. Mm. And if the farm can maintain itself in a holistic, sustainable fashion, then it can thrive and grow and be truly sustainable.
Wow. That's so great. And being out there, it was so wonderful to see the animals that you have. So can you tell us a little bit about the different kinds of animals that you have on the farm, and what do they produce?
Well, we love to have the animals on the farm. We grow a lot of laying hens, and those girls are giving us eggs, and they're giving us manure, and they're eating the bugs and that we give them to eat, and so we don't have to squash the bugs. The chickens do that. We also raise dairy goats and milk them and make cheese out of the milk. We also have honeybees. We have 6 hives on the property that we extract the honey from. And so the bees are doing their job. They're pollinating the crops. The chickens are eating the bugs. We're getting fertilizer and eggs from them. The goats are doing their job. They're eating the weeds, and they're excreting into our compost piles as well. And then we're getting cheese and milk from the goats as well. So it's a really nice holistic system that we have on the property.
It was great to meet. I love meeting the goats.
Yeah, they're so cute.
They are very affectionate.
Yeah.
And you also have worms.
Wow, thanks for reminding me. That's a great question. Worms, the keeping of worms is called vermiculture. And that's one of the things that we do to add fertility and create our own fertility on the farm. So we have lots of compost piles, but we also have worm bins. And we've stocked them with red worms and wigglers that are excreting. They're going through a bunch of the effluent that comes off of our farms, extra squashes and things that are getting too big, we'll throw into the worm bins, and they eat it. They poop, and that manure is called castings, worm castings. It's some of the most potent and wonderful organic fertility that we could put on the farm.
Wow,
we love it.
Yeah, it was exciting to see them too. I mean, the worm bin is big.
Yeah, you can open it up, grab a big old handful of worms, and become in awe of the worm.
Yeah. That was great. Can you tell us how you talk about field of greens, whatever, but they aren't really fields. The way that you have organized the farm is a little bit different than rows and rows and rows in a field that some people may visualize. Can you explain how you have designed the farm?
Well, I had to design the farm based on the topography. So we are on a south-facing slope with very short terraces, and we have to grow on these terraces. Not only are there sloping terraces like this, but each terrace is kind of undulates. Mm-hmm. So if I put a garden bed every 4 feet on perpendicular to the hill on our sloped land, then they end up being looking like garden beds that people have in their backyard. Mm-hmm. And one of the advantages of that is since we're a teaching facility, we have all sorts of people on the farm taking gardening classes. We get to take them out in on the terraces, show them exactly how to amend a bed, plant a bed, sow a bed, double dig a bed, and they can start extrapolating and say, well, Love Apple has 4 feet by 12 feet beds. I could have a couple 3-4 by 12 feet beds in my backyard. And so everything that we do on the farm can be extrapolated and taken back to somebody's backyard garden. And that's why a lot of our students really appreciate coming to the farm, because it's very indicative of what they can do too at home.
Absolutely. And that was an inspiration to me, because I thought, wow, these beds are what, about 8x4, could fit in a very small space. And the way that you plant them too is so interesting, because it's not like everything blooms at once and is harvested all at once. You've got it staged so that it's constantly producing over a long period of time. Can you explain kind of how that's designed? And
that's one of the toughest things we do. We have a restaurant account we grow for Manresa Restaurant in Las Gatas. We've had an exclusive partnership for 8 years now. So we grow for them 12 months out of the year, 52 weeks out of the year. We have to give them something edible, wonderful, flavorful, gorgeous, and a wide variety of things as well. So that means that at any one time, we'll have one bed of carrots ready, and then another bed of carrots on the other side of the property, maybe 3 weeks from being ready, and then yet another bed maybe being 6 or 7 weeks from being ready to harvest from. And then finally, maybe we'll have a newly sown bed of carrots that we've done yesterday that will eventually be the mature one in 2 or 3 months from now. And we do that with 300 different varieties of fruit, veg, herbs, and edible flowers for Manresa Restaurant. They're one of the finest restaurants in the world, so it makes us really have to up our game to produce fabulous veg for such a fine establishment. Yeah. It's challenging.
but so rewarding. And everything that's sitting here today in our studio is destined to be dinner tonight at Manresa.
Yes.
So that's exciting. And there's some really unusual things here. So can you kind of pick a couple of these unusual ones and explain what they are? Because I'm not sure that everybody thinks about greens in such variety, both for flavor as well as for color. And these are gorgeous. They're just beautiful.
Thank you. These aren't even all the greens that we grow for the restaurant, but I brought some that I thought were particularly interesting. This one's called a red vein sorrel, and it's got a very lemony flavor to it, despite the fact that it looks green and red. And the chef can even make desserts out of it because it's got such a tart lemon flavor to it. We also have loads and loads of lettuces, but also these baby kales. This is red Russian kale, and in the grocery store or the farmer's market, this leaf would be gigantic. But the chef loves the small little sprout leaves, and he can put that on a dish as a garnish or one of the many ingredients of one of their famous dishes called Into the Vegetable Garden, which has 30 to 60 ingredients on that salad, if you will, at any one time. It's supposed to be representative of a walk through Love Apple Farms.
Oh, that's great. And how about this one? This one's very unusual.
This is, you had a good eye, Susan. This is called Malabar spinach. It's a succulent. It's a vining plant, so we grow it on a trellis. Mm. But we also give Chef David Kinch these small sprouts. It's a fabulous tasting and visually appealing succulent with a red stem and a thick green, dark green leaf. So it's quite interesting for the chef to put this on a plate and have a lot of the patrons be the first time they've ever tried Malabar spinach. Mm-hmm. It's exciting for them and for the chef, too, to try and do something different than other chefs, other restaurants. And it's exciting for the farmer, too, because I get to go find interesting ingredients for him and grow them. And hopefully nobody else is doing that for another chef in the country.
Oh, that's great. Now, the name of the farm is Love Apple. So I think everybody knows that love apples are tomatoes. Why did you name it Love Apple?
Well, I used to be in a different location. And when I first started 15 years ago in Ben Lomond, my farmhouse was built by Harry Love, a minor figure in California history. And then I fell in love with tomatoes, and I just started being just a tomato grower. And I figured between Harry Love and Love Apple, meaning tomatoes, that was a good name for my farm.
Perfect. I love it. I love it.
I know that people are passionate about their tomatoes, so it's because it makes sense that it be called Love Apples.
Yeah. Yeah. And you produce a huge variety of heritage tomatoes.
Yes, we do. We grow 100 varieties of heirloom tomatoes every year. And when I first started farming, that was a little revenue stream for me to sell my tomato plants to my neighbors. And now we have the largest tomato plant sale in California at Love Apple Farms. We're ending it this weekend because we've gone through the whole season and we've sold all the plants and they're going out to good homes and being planted in Bay Area gardens. And hopefully we'll have tens of thousands of baby Love Apple farms all around the Bay Area.
Oh, I bet that's going to be awesome. And my sister-in-law actually has purchased tomatoes from you, and she told me that people can come and ask you what variety will work in their own situation, because, of course, different people have different exposures, and there's microclimates within the Bay Area as well as around the country and around the world. And so are there certain varieties that do better in certain locations?
Absolutely. I think that when you start to realize that the differences among tomatoes are not only a culinary difference, but a climactic difference, then you can discern what varieties will do best in your climate. So, for example, in the Bay Area of California, we have so many microclimates. One of them is right on the coast where you get a lot of coastal fog, up in San Francisco where the fog rolls in every day. People should be sticking to small fruiting tomatoes, like cherry tomatoes or something a little bit bigger than a cherry, maybe a golf ball size. That is going to give them a lot more fruit than if they were trying to insist on growing a really large beefsteak tomato. Mm-hmm. Those are for folks that have all day long sunlight, maybe in San Jose, in the interior valley, anything that gives them a lot more sunlight, you're going to have to grow a bigger fruiting tomato.
Uh-huh. Mm, that's a good tip, because even in my own backyard, I have an area that's super sunny, mm-hmm. and I've been able to grow all bigger tomatoes, but then the front yard is not much sun at all, and only had success with the smaller ones.
Well, at least you put the small ones in there, and that's really the way to do it. Put the cherry tomatoes where you don't have as much sunlight, and fog is a sunlight damp inhibitor. So as long as you put the large fruiters where the most sunlight is, and we feed the heck out of our tomatoes. We mm-hmm. put all sorts of stuff in the bottom of our tomato planting hole. We put a fish head. We put worm castings. We put fertilizers. We put bone meal. We put all of these goodies in there to ensure that the tomato has a lot of nutrition as it's growing.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the keys to a great tomato and a so-so tomato.
And when do you plant tomatoes in the Bay Area?
Well, in the Bay Area, never before April 1st. If you're really by the coast with that fog, you could get away with April 1st all the way up till April 15th. And then if you're a little bit inland, where it tends to get one last bit of frost in mid to late April, then you want to really wait until May 1st. If you're up in the mountains, Boulder Creek, Summit area, Mount Tamil Pious, those areas, you really have to wait until May 1st to plant, to be successful.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a season for everything, and for tomatoes, it's the warm weather. That's mm-hmm. what they really have to have.
And is this planting by seed or planting the little
stalks? It's planting the seedling, a tomato seedling. This is not a tomato seedling, but this is about the size that a tomato mm-hmm. seedling would be when you plant it, and that would be your planting date. But when you start from seed, you want to start in either late January or February, about 8 weeks before you want to plant out. Mm-hmm. So if your planting date was April 1st, then you'd want to start on February 1st sowing your seed, and you do that indoors where it's nice and warm. You cultivate the plant, you talk to it nicely, mm-hmm. you give it some worm casting tea, you give it lots of sunlight, you bring it inside at night where it's warm, and then 8 weeks later you'll have a gorgeous tomato plant to put out in your amended tomato bed.
Great. Oh boy, makes me hungry.
Me too.
We're surrounded by all this good food and talking about lovely tomatoes.
And no ripe tomatoes just yet.
No,
but we're working on
early,
it.
Been mm-hmm. early. Another thing that you have at the farm are bees.
Yes.
And why do you have bees there?
Well, we have at the farm, you have to have more than one job. So the only thing that only has one job are my dogs. They just sit down at the feet of my desk. They don't even go and chase varmints. But everything else has to have at least a double or even a triple purpose. So the bees, they give us honey. They give us wax for making candles or whatnot. They also pollinate the crops. And with natural pollinators becoming less and less out there in the wild, we want to ensure that our crops get pollinated. And so we have six hives. A lot of the honey goes over to the restaurant, and they create lots of dishes out of the honey, including one of their signature cocktails called the Santa Cruz 75 has Love Apple Farms honey in it.
Oh, nice. So everything on the farm is used locally.
Yes. Uh-huh.
And Manresa is very local. It's just a few miles away from the farm. So even the carbon footprint is so minimal.
We try our best. We can't save all of our seed because of some cross-pollination issues, but we save as many seeds as we can. We do buy outside fertilizers, but we create as much fertility as we possibly can on the farm, and we include Manresa in our closed loop. And that means that we go twice a week and collect all of their compostables,
great.
Bring it back to the farm, put it in the compost pile, get that going, add our animal manures to it. 6 months later, it's ready to go back on our growing beds. And it's a nice system.
Perfect.
Reducing our
it.
Carbon footprint.
Yeah. It's so great. It's so great for Love Apple Farm, and it's so great for Manresa, the community, the planet.
Yeah.
It's just awesome. That's so great. Love Apple Farm is a education center, mm-hmm. as well as a cooking school.
Right.
You have all kinds of things happening here beyond growing this incredible stuff. What kinds of, well, first of all, it must take an army to run this.
Well, it feels like it takes an army. We have 5 farm apprentices that live on the farm. They're learning how to be farmers. They're folks who are either starting out their career or they're transitioning from another career into farming. I call it a calling. I think you really have to want to work in the dirt and the bugs and the heat and the or the cold weather, mm-hmm. pouring rain, in order to nurture something that sustains us as a family and a community. So they're living on the farm with me. They're working and learning. But more importantly, we have about 100 classes on the farm mm-hmm. every year. And we started with gardening classes, and now we've branched out to cooking classes as well. We have cheese making, bread making, beer making for a little bit of fun and spirit. We also have, of course, traditional beekeeping. We have chicken keeping where people can learn how to keep their own backyard chickens. They take home 3 little baby girl chicks, feed, waterer, chicken coop plans. We teach them how to make their chicken coop predator-proof in the city. We have summer vegetable gardening, herb growing, perennial growing, all sorts of things. And then some higher-end cooking classes as well, like macarons, pad thai, chocolate truffles, things that are a little bit more fancy, but still a fun place to be on the farm, because then you can go out walking through the vegetable beds, and the instructor chef is actually gathering things from the beds for the classes, and it's a great respite during the middle of a class to go out and view the gardens.
Yeah, and you also have a pizza class, you were telling me.
We have a pizza making class coming up this Sunday, and we're going to be teaching that quite often, and the instructor is going to be able to teach students not only how to make pizza from scratch, make your own dough, yeast, have it rise, sauces from scratch, but also how to cook it not only in a traditional regular oven in your kitchen, but a wood-fired pizza oven. She's going to show that as well as on a grill. So we've got 3 different methods of cooking the pizza. Yeah.
And with good stuff on the top, I'm sure.
From the farm. Yeah, we'll have arugula, we'll have eggplant, we'll have tomatoes, we'll have all sorts of herbs from the farm as well.
It makes my mouth water just thinking about it. That's so great.
Take a cheese making class, then you put the cheese on the pizza that you're making, and then you take a beer making class, and so your cheese from your goats or an egg from your chickens on the pizza, vegetables on your pizza, and then accompanied it by a fine handcrafted homebrew beer.
Perfect.
That sounds great.
And you eat it out in the picnic area, which you have at the farm.
Yes, we do. Or in your own backyard after we teach you how to make all these things.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's so great. It's so great. I was very impressed when I was out there that the apprentice that I met is a young lady. So how many women do you have apprenticing in proportion to the guys?
That's a great question. You know, farming is enjoying a real renaissance, small organic farming, and it seems to be attracting a disproportionate percentage of women over men right now. And yeah. I don't know if it's because Love Apple is a woman-owned farm, and so I'm getting a lot of applications from women, or if it's just in general, other small farms are enjoying that kind of a different structure than tradition. So we see a lot of young women. We've got more women than men on the farm right now, and we seem to always have more women than men. And I enjoy it. It's great to mentor other people that want to be farmers. I keep wanting to say young people, but not all of our apprentices are spring chickens. We've had some middle-aged folks who have decided, you know what, farming is my calling. I want to give up the corporate world, and I want to be a farmer. And Love Apple is a great place to learn how to do that.
So Quinn, what brought you here? Why did you decide to be an apprentice at Love Apple Farm?
I applied to be an apprentice here in order to witness the farm-to-table transformation that happens, and I'm very lucky because I get to see the vegetables go from seed to the plate, which I think is an undervalued system that happens in in restaurants all over the place, and we're very lucky to supply to this restaurant and have this exchange. I'm also here for the educational opportunities. I'm learning a lot about propagating plants, growing, and we get to go to a lot of class. We get to assist in all the classes. I feel like I'm learning a lot here. Well, I'm hoping to finish up my education, get my degree in probably in plant biology. And I'm hoping that I can get more experience working on farms or in gardens and increase my knowledge of how growing food works.
Oh, that's great. Mm-hmm. That's great. Well, I'm very encouraged that there are women that are choosing this as a viable career or augmenting their lifestyle. Mm-hmm. Because we need to be more conscious about what we eat and growing our own food and knowing how to do it in a biodynamic way so that we don't impact our environment, whether it's in our backyard in the city or out in the country. I really encourage people to go online to look at your website. And why don't you give us the website address?
It's loveapplefarms.com, plural, loveapplefarms.com. We have lots of pictures. We have lots of tours that people can come to the farm, and we'd love to show them around and show them how to grow great vegetables.
Great. Well, thank you so much. This has been a lot of fun. It's made me incredibly hungry. And I can't wait to go up there again. It's a wonderful place, and you're doing a great service for the community and for Manresa and for the environment. And thank you so much for being our show today. This has just been really, really fun.
Thank you, Susan. I've enjoyed it.
Great. Thank you. Thank you for joining us on The Better Part. You can view more of our programs on Cupertino TV Productions on YouTube.